Welcome to Lingthusiasm, a podcast that's enthusiastic about linguistics. I'm Gretchen McCulloch.
And I'm Lauren Gawne, and today we're getting enthusiastic about negation.
Or we're not getting unenthusiastic about negation, if you will.
We're not getting enthusiastic about negation, but first, we just want to say thanks to everyone who became a patron or was a patron and came to our April live show that was part of Lingfest.
It was really fun to get to see and hear from you all in the chat and on social media. And this show has been edited and put up on our Patreon bonus feed if you want to listen to it in audio only, like a normal podcast. So you can listen to it on Patreon if you didn't catch it live. We'd also like to thank everybody who came to Lingfest in general. All of the great events that people put on were really fun. It was really great to see all of the community around that.
And Lingfest came on the back of Lingcom 21, which was our conference for people doing Lingcom, which was also a lovely experience. So thanks to everyone who participated in one or both of those events.
There is nothing to be suspicious about here.
That's good, because I absolutely did not eat the whole secret stash of chocolate while you weren't looking.
And I definitely didn't spill water everywhere.
I totally have not adopted a pet dinosaur.
And the moon is absolutely in its usual position, and no one has blown it up, especially not me.
I am quite dubious, and I'm just going to wait until I can definitely check that by looking at the moon.
I am also a little bit worried about the status of your dinosaur or dinosaur-free lifestyle.
I don't have a pet dinosaur. I was very clear. No dinosaur.
But if you haven't had a pet dinosaur the entire time I've known you, why are you bringing it up today?
Every day I have not had a pet dinosaur, and yet bringing it up today somehow makes it feel relevant in a way a bit like we talked about on our episode on Gricean maxims, where you only talk about things because they are relevant.
Yeah, and, you know, just like I have not been blowing up the moon every single day of my life.
Thankfully.
Yet somehow, when I start saying it like that, it also reminds me of a feature of the podcast Welcome to Night Vale, which is a, you know, delightfully surreal podcast. And there's this bit in episode 8 that I wrote about back in 2013 when I was first listening to Welcome to Night Vale that also uses negation in a very similar sort of way. So it's, here's the quote. We're receiving word from the city council that there was absolutely not a Pink Floyd multimedia laser spectacular this weekend at Radon Canyon. There never was a Pink Floyd multimedia laser spectacular ever near Night Vale. Pink Floyd is not even a thing, said the council in a statement. And yet at the same time, you're sort of left with this impression that...
That's a lot of denying.
Yeah. You know, it's sort of, you know, methinks thou dost protest too much, or like, why are you protesting so much? Surely every day, you know, near my house, there is not a Pink Floyd multimedia laser spectacular, and yet no one has felt obliged to inform me of this.
It's because the only times we talk about something not happening is because the absence of something is relevant. And so language takes a kind of default positive talking about things that are here or do exist, and it's the lack of something that gets overtly marked in the grammar of languages.
Right, but it's also the lack of something brings in this presupposition that the lack of something is a relevant thing to talk about, or that it could have been expected but hasn't happened. You know, if I say something like, I haven't eaten dinner yet today, that's not, you know, ontologically weird, sort of philosophically weird, in the same way I don't have a pet dinosaur is weird. Because it is still an open question on any given day whether or not I've had dinner. Or if I say I don't have a cat, that is an open question that reasonable people sometimes do have cats, and so it could be reasonably relevant that I might or might not have a cat in the way that it's not reasonably relevant that I might or might not have a pet dinosaur.
And so this shows up in the grammar where the default is positive and you don't add anything to a sentence usually to indicate that something's positive. You have to add something to the grammar to show that it's negative.
Yeah, and if you look at the World Atlas of Linguistic Structures, which is, you know, a great set of maps that is available on the internet for free for people to look at, and they have over 1,000 languages on their negation map, and they have a bunch of different ways that languages can indicate negation, you know, whether you add a different word or whether you change something about the verb or whether you add two things or other things like that. But in over 1,000 languages, all of them have something you add to make the sentence negative. Not, for example, something you take away.
Yeah, you get to this point with language as a consistent feature of language where the absence of something or the negation of something is indicated by adding something to the grammar, whether that's a word or a morpheme that affixes to a word.
Which is sort of, you know, philosophically weird when you think about it, right? Because why is the presence of something indicated with the version of the sentence that has less in it, and the absence of something is indicated by the version of the sentence that has more in it?
I think it definitely goes back to the initial examples we used where actually talking about the absence of something only happens when absence is relevant, because there is not a dinosaur in my house every day, but I absolutely don't need to point out every day all the things that are not in my house.
You don't have any zebras either?
I just start the day by rattling them off.
Listing every single animal that's not in my house every day before I do anything else.
And so we tend to only talk about the absence of something when it's relevant. And this is part of why negation is kind of an additive thing to the grammar. And we think about the positive version of the utterance as somehow being more default.
It's actually kind of similar to how when you think about numbers, like 1 and 2 and 3 were invented a long time before the number 0 was invented.
Yeah.
And, you know, even though before you have 1 of something, you have 0 of it, but it wasn't being commented on in a numerical sort of way. It might have been being commented on in a negative sort of way, because languages do have negation, but it wasn't being commented on as, I have 0 dinosaurs.
Why negation is something that's kept mathematicians and philosophers and people doing logic and linguists entertained and many other people entertained for such a long time, and why we're giving it its own whole episode.
We're not doing a negation episode.
Alongside the strong consistency of having some kind of additional marking to indicate negation, these particular gestures to indicate negation seems to be one of the more consistent things that languages do across families.
Ah, I love it when you have a gesture tie-in.
For a couple of centuries, people have grappled with the fact that shaking the head to indicate no is incredibly prevalent across languages, and way more prevalent and consistent than nodding is to indicate yes.
Oh, that's interesting.
And the generally agreed upon theory is that shaking your head to indicate no starts really early when infants are refusing food, because it's something you have an imperative to do.
No, don't want this food, no.
Mm-hmm. Even Charles Darwin wrote a book that I think it was just going to be like a chapter of the origin of the species, and he just got way into it looking at gestures across humans and other animals and different languages.
Amazing.
And was like, the head shake for no is really consistent. How people indicate yes is less consistent, and it just seems to be do something that isn't no, whereas no seems to be the starting point.
That's interesting.
And so you have this really consistent pattern with head shaking. And you also have these like families of gestural tendencies across languages where people use some kind of away motion for negation with their hands.
Oh, like, oh no, I can't. Okay, yeah, I'm doing some sort of like sweeping away from my shoulders.
Yeah, so a pushing away or a sweeping away or a throwing away are all part of this family that have been looked at across languages. And I have just published a paper in a journal, Semiotica, about this kind of flicking away, rolling away gesture that you get in Shuba narratives when people are talking about the absence or the lack of something in a story. And all of these types of away negation seem to also tap into this human conceptualization of negation as something pushed away from or held away from the body. Away and negation seems to fit
it's
together
not
in our,
near me. And that, yes, that actually ties into this idea that the affirmative, the positive, the non-negative form is the sort of default, because if you're pushing it away from your body, that sort of implies that it was near your body in the first place.
Yeah. And that, like, we have a very bodily lived experience of existing and things being here or not being here. Although that is a good point. I've been just talking about the positive, but there is a technical linguist term for not negative, which is affirmative. Probably mention that.
I feel like people may have encountered affirmative in like a very robot voice, you know, affirmative, destroy all the humans or something like that.
It's one of those times where you're like, oh good, a technical term that's going to be already, it's already part of my vocabulary. It's a win.
And it's interesting because you could imagine a language where the default meaning is actually negative and instead you add something to make it affirmative.
This is a hard to wrap your head around constructed language experiment.
None of the languages in Walls do this apparently, but you know, you have English which has like, I don't have a pet dino, which is the negative, and I have a pet dino, which is the affirmative. And English Prime, which is what linguists do when they're trying to make up a language that is very similar to English but differs on like one thing, so we don't have to make up new words the whole way through, where you could say something like, I have a pet dino, meaning I don't have one, because that's the default form of the sentence. And then if you have like, I af have a pet dino, which means I do have one, where the af is like a fake word that means affirmative. And that's just like not a thing you see grammatically.
I have learnt many languages. I have encountered complex grammars of many languages. And this actually hurts my brain to conceptualize as a way of speaking. In English, we have a variety of ways of expressing negation in the grammar. Grammar, we have separate words like no or not that we can use to make a whole sentence negative. Or we also have affixes that we can use to make a particular word negative. So unenthusiastic would be an example from the top of the show. Or unhappy, unexciting, uninteresting, hopeless. So there are a variety of strategies that English has to do negating. It's not just one particular thing.
Yeah, and the word formation side of negation often brings up the sort of question of the fossilized words that English has in its vocabulary that look like they have a negative part to them, but we don't have the positive version of them anymore. So you have things like ruthless or feckless or unkempt, but we don't have like ruthful or feckful or kempt.
Kempt. Yes.
There's a great poem about this, which we can link to. But what's interesting is, so I've actually been, this is shameless, shameless bragging moment here. I was reading an advanced copy of Arika Okrent's upcoming book.
I will be jealous about this on behalf of everyone, because Arika Okrent wrote an amazing book about conlanging called In the Land of Invented Languages, probably like a decade ago now, and has a new book about English grammar and its wonderful weirdnesses coming out in the middle of 2021.
Yeah, her book is called Highly Irregular. It's coming out on July 1st, 2021. And she makes this really interesting point in the advanced copy, which is, we joke about the missing flip sides of hapless, ruthless, and feckless, but not about we should be able to form, but don't, from bashful, grateful, and wistful.
Huh. I feel like this is a reaction I have when I read Arika's work a lot. I'm just like, oh yeah, I hadn't thought about that before.
Yeah, so there's no like bashless, grateless, or wistless. You know, even though it feels natural that there should be a missing positive form of forms that have a negative, we don't have the same reaction of a missing negative form of things that have a positive, which also gets into that positive as default form.
These things always seem so consistent on the surface, and then you look at how people actually use them and what gets actively used and what becomes fossils, and you realize that applying negation is a little more complicated.
And then on the flip side of, you know, affirmative is no negation at all, there's also this thing of like, what if you have extra negation? What if you want to make something even more emphatically negated? I absolutely did not get a baby dinosaur. Nope, no siree, nuh-uh, didn't happen.
Some languages can put in more than one negating word to really emphasize that something is negated, which is a strategy you might be familiar with as double negation, which occurs in about 10% of the world's languages.
Yeah, this is a strategy that I'm really familiar with in French, because that's the default way of doing negation, that in formal written French, you have at least two negative words, and sometimes you can put in more. So the default way of doing that is a ne before the verb and a pa after the verb, but sometimes the pa can change into something else. So ne verb pa is not, but if you have ne verb personne, that's no one, or ne verb rien, that's nothing. So even if I just want to say, like, I did not receive a baby dinosaur, it would be je n'ai pas reçu un dinosaur, which is dinosaur in French, in case that wasn't clear. And you have the ne and the pas there. Although in spoken French, a lot of times the ne gets dropped, and so you just have pas indicating negation.
And the ne is the older part, right?
Yeah. So English actually historically had a second negative particle that was before the verb. So if you have like, I cannot, it was more like something like I ne cannot. And they were both there, and then the early one gets dropped. So this happens sometimes that you get negatives sort of reinforcing each other, and then, oh, now we don't need this one.
So if we revisited those 120 languages with double negation in the walls map in a century, because languages are constantly changing and moving around in their grammar, some of them might have dropped one of those negative elements and gone back to being a single negation language, and some languages might add a second one and become a language that has double negation, and French is kind of in the middle of doing that at the moment.
Yeah, and this process is, in linguistic research, is called negative concord rather than double negation, because mm-hmm. it's not just two of them necessarily. A language that has negative concord can continue stacking negative elements like nothing and no one and all of these on top, like I didn't give nothing to no one. That's totally the expected way of saying it in French.
It's interesting that gloss works as the expected form in French, because it is totally grammatically viable for some dialects of English, but it's often stigmatized as being not acceptable or not part of standard English.
And the thing that drives me up the wall about the logic for doing that is that the logic for stigmatizing it is, quote-unquote, two negatives form a positive. But what this logic doesn't realize is that it's extremely spurious logic.
Right.
It's a misuse of how logic works.
Do you want to unpack that for us? Because I personally find joy in the fact that language is more interesting than logic. But if people have encountered this argument, where does it fall down for you?
So, first of all, languages like French exist.
Yeah, I do wonder how much more mileage double negation or negative concord in English would get if we called it the French negation.
Right. Like, oh, it's like French toast. Everyone likes things that are French. like the French toast negation style. And like, there were plenty of early logicians who were French who were surely not making this argument that doesn't even work for their language in the only way that they were doing things in like Descartes' time.
Language is not just numbers.
Well, and also, in English, nobody's confused about the difference between I didn't give nothing to nobody and I'm not excited. Like, those both use multiple negations, and in one of them, the negation is trying to cancel out the negation, and in the other one, it's reinforcing the negation, and we do know what people mean. Like, it's not actually confusing.
In fact, we can throw even more negation into the way that we speak, and people cope with it really fine.
Yeah, and the other thing is that, I don't want to get completely linguist on the logicians, but languages have been around for a lot longer than logic has.
True.
like formal logic has existed for, I don't know what, like Aristotle? So a couple thousand years, if we're going to be generous?
Mm-hmm.
And language has been around for like, somewhere in the tens of thousands of years, we're not even sure whether it's tens or hundreds of thousands because we literally don't have records. But like just several orders of magnitude longer than logic has existed, language mm-hmm. has been around. And if we think that roughly 10% of languages have negative concord now, probably some fraction of languages have always had negative concord because it's a thing that people could do. And so it's a bit rich for logic, this like young interloper, to come into language, which has been doing just fine this entire time, and be like, sorry, you need to like redo your entire system because I don't like it. Like, who are you? It's so young.
With that in mind, should we try squeezing even more negation into a sentence?
Yes.
Because we can do better than just double negatives for negative concord.
Yes. This is where we can do one of my favorite examples, which is the Mean Girls approach to negation.
Okay.
And this is...
Not what I expected to be your favorite example, but let's go.
I mean, look, any excuse to have a Mean Girls reference. and that's the she doesn't even go here type of negation.
Mm-hmm.
when you have several bits in a sentence that are actually negative, you could still take one out, and that's what makes the logical argument sort of superficially appealing, because you could get rid of someone. They're just sort of reinforcing each other. But in this case, you have, she doesn't even go here. And if you try to make that positive, she does even go here?
She even goes here? She, I'm taking out the, and she does even go here. Doesn't work for me.
Yeah. Or like, you could do it with a different stress. Like, she even goes here.
Or you, like, I guess the affirmative form of this would just be, she goes here.
Yeah.
The even doesn't turn up at all.
Right. And so the even there is doing something interesting. And it's reinforcing the negation without itself being negative per se in isolation, just sort of not being around at all without the negative there to help it.
So I guess it would be like a sentence like, I don't like ice cream at all, which,
right, like, apart would you
from
say,
being a fake fact.
Would you say I like ice cream at all?
I would just say I like ice cream.
Right. The positive version
the
of that.
At all doesn't need to be there at all.
Or I didn't eat a crumb of cake, which you can say I ate a crumb of cake, but it's not quite the opposite of I didn't eat a crumb of cake.
It's a little bit too literal in the affirmative version.
Yeah. Or something like, I didn't touch a drop of water. If I say,
I touched a drop of water, I just like boop it with my finger.
Just going through the rain, like booping raindrops.
That one absolutely does not work when you keep a drop of water in there. That construction only works for me in the negative, even though a lot of the words in it that are adding to the negation aren't necessarily negative in their structure.
Yeah, exactly. And it's saying, I didn't touch even the smallest amount of water is what that's sort of doing mm-hmm. there. And there's that even again.
Mm-hmm.
And coincidentally, this is also something that Arika Okrent talks about in her book, Highly Irregular, which is coming out. And it's not only a book about negation, I promise. I was just thinking about negation because I knew we were doing this episode when I was reading it.
Also, as you can tell from the examples, negation is where grammar starts to get particularly interesting. So it's unsurprising that a book like Highly Irregular would have a couple of stories about negation in it.
Yeah, because there are interesting things to say there. And Arika Okrent has this great section which talks about things like even and any and at all and a drop of, which are mm-hmm. called negative polarity items, if you want a technical term for it.
This is a technical term that I know but hadn't really thought about until we started putting the show together. But I guess that by items, they just mean things that are words or multiple words, because a crumb of isn't a word. We can't just call them negative polarity words.
Right, exactly. So some of them are individual words like any or yet or even or either. Some of them are longer phrases like at all or a thing or an iota, mm-hmm. a drop. You even get verbs like budge.
In a sentence like?
Like the boulder won't budge. And you don't say the boulder will budge.
Hmm. I guess some of these are like, huh. Sorry, I'm just going to take a moment to consult my intuitions there. Because, like, man, I guess not.
Yeah. You know, I mean, you'll do it in the, I might be able to say, like, budge over or something to a person. But yeah. And then you have whole phrases like breathe a word, hold a candle, sleep a wink, lift a finger.
I couldn't sleep a wink.
I could sleep a wink. I could lift a finger.
And when you put them into the affirmative, they don't work, but it also shows why they're just called negative polarity rather than negation, because they bring this negative sense with them, but they are not doing grammatical negating themselves. There's no or not or aren't in there.
Yeah, and that's what distinguishes them from something like no one, nowhere, nothing, which are themselves already negative words. Hmm. And if you think about the polarity of a phrase as like, I guess, if you go away from the equator, let's say you go north for negation, because they both begin with N. And so, like, as you head towards the North Pole, your negative polarity gets higher.
As someone who lives on a continent that is often called the antipodes, because we are on the opposite side of the world from the Northern Hemisphere, I appreciate that you're using north as your deficit for negation. Thank you.
I don't know. Acronyms, they're nice.
Yeah, N for north, N for negation. negative polarity items are just like sending you in that direction without necessarily being negative themselves.
Yeah. And what's interesting about them is, although they're called negative polarity items because of this very sort of canonical contrast where you say there aren't any here versus there are any here, mm-hmm. which is, you know, weird because it doesn't have the negation. There are also some other contexts where you can say stuff like this.
Okay.
So you can say negative polarity items in questions often. Do you see any?
True. Yeah.
Or in if clauses.
Okay. And if clauses are kind of famous for not existing quite in our reality. That's one of the things
right.
they're doing.
Right. Like, if you make a peep, you'll get in trouble. So the if part of that, you know, oh, somehow that works for negative polarity. And also context with words like without or doubt or surprise or regret. So that's something like, I regret lifting a finger to help. You're not going to say, I lifted a finger to help, because that one's weird. But as soon as you regret lifting a finger, somehow that one works fairly well.
So they're not just doing straight up negating. There's something more complicated happening there.
Right. And this is something that's still an active area of research to figure out exactly what all the contexts are, because some of the negative polarity items work better in some contexts than others. And so there can be a bit of fuzziness around the borders for which ones work when, and the theories for the reasons behind those conditions can get fairly complicated. But it's interesting to have this observation of, like, here's this whole class of words that, like, you knew about nouns and verbs, but, like, negative polarity items, they've been there this whole time, and yet you didn't realize they had this unifying characteristic of them.
And there might be sometimes when something that's listed as a negative polarity item actually works in the affirmative for some people, and why intuition checking becomes a big part of thinking about this. Because I've definitely met some people who can use any more, which I can only use in negative, like, I don't have a dinosaur anymore.
oh no, what happened to it?
But there are some English speakers who can use any more in a positive sentence. And whenever I hear it, I'm like, oh, that works for you. But I literally can't even come up with an example in my head because it doesn't work in my variety of English.
Yeah, I have a fun story about positive any more, which is I didn't have it growing up. And mm-hmm. I encountered it in grad school in this very, like, you know, did you know that in some varieties of English, people have positive any more? And I was reading the examples and being told these examples, so it's something like cake is expensive anymore.
Alas.
Where it means sort of nowadays.
And I can totally understand it functioning when you use it in a sentence like that. It's not like my brain can't process the meaning at all. It's just not something I would say.
But I actually went to a linguistics conference.
Mm-hmm.
And I went to a workshop by a linguist who had positive any more. And the first time I heard him say it in the wild, I was like, oh, this is this thing that I've read about in the books. And then, like, 3 days later, I'd heard this linguist on enough occasions say enough tokens of positive anymore that I'm like, yeah, it's grammatical for me now. I acquired it in this 1 week in 2012.
Amazing.
So sometimes, like, the only reason you don't have positive anymore is because you only have negative evidence to suggest that
yeah,
it doesn't exist.
Yeah, I just haven't been exposed to it.
And then I had, like, I don't know, probably less than a dozen tokens of positive evidence in this naturalistic setting from this linguist who didn't realize that he was grammatically teaching me to use positive anymore. He thought he was doing a workshop on a perfectly unrelated topic. And yet I walked out of that being like, yeah, it's grammatical for me. And it has been ever since.
You are an inspiration for lifelong grammatical acquisition.
Right. Because I was an adult. It's great.
And now you called it positive anymore. So the fact that we have negative polarity items, can I intuit that there are also positive polarity items?
Yeah, there aren't as many, but one of them is...
Interesting. Again, this obsession with marking negation.
Yeah, because again, we mark negation a lot more, but one of them is somewhat.
Hmm.
And so you can say, I liked that cake somewhat.
We're definitely not moving as close to the positive pole with the somewhat there.
I didn't like that cake somewhat. Is just kind of rough for a lot of people.
Yeah, that doesn't work for me.
Yeah. So there are a few positive polarity items as well that move people further towards the South Pole, if you will.
I like that talking about positive polarity items has moved us full circle through negation and back into thinking about negation and thinking about negative structures and affirmative structures as all part of this larger, more complicated system of ways that we have of expressing that things exist or they don't exist, and how we go about talking about that. For more Lingthusiasm and links to all the things mentioned in this episode, go to lingthusiasm.com. You can listen to us on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, SoundCloud, YouTube, or wherever else you get your podcasts, and you can follow at Lingthusiasm on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Tumblr. You can get IPA scarves, esoteric symbol socks, and other Lingthusiasm merch at lingthusiasm.com/merch. I tweet and blog as Superlinguo.
I can be found as at Gretchen E. McSee on Twitter. My blog is allthingslinguistic.com, and my book about internet language is called Because Internet. Have you listened to all the Lingthusiasm episodes and you wish there were more? You can get access to 49 bonus episodes to listen to right now at patreon.com/lingthusiasm, or follow the links from our website. Patrons also get access to our Discord chat room to talk with other linguistics fans and other rewards, as well as helping keep the show ad-free. Recent bonus topics include reduplication, an AMA with a lexicographer, and the recording of our live show. Can't afford to pledge? That's okay, too. We also really appreciate if you can recommend Lingthusiasm to anyone who needs a little more linguistics in their life.
Lingthusiasm is produced by Gretchen McCulloch and Lauren Gawne. Our senior producer is Claire Gawne. Our editorial producer is Sarah Doppiarella. And our music is Ancient City by The Triangles.
Stay Lingthusiastic! Don't stay unlingthusiastic!